Good morning to everyone, and thanks for having me here. It's always a pleasure to every summer to meet the group. And our theme is political violence in the book of Sefer Shmuel. And I want to start before getting into a close reading of. The two chapters we want to read closely, I want to structure my conversation on four themes on power. Four themes that emerge from the reflections of our author on the nature of power. The first theme has to do with the fact that power tends to instrumentalize its environment. There is never a pure act of, a pure clean act coming from those who are in power. And that fact emerges in the book at different moments. I just want to give two examples in which instrumentalization reaches to the realms of the fabric of human relationship, which usually are not instrumentalized. That's what they are. I'm talking about love and the sacred. It is love and the sacred that resists instrumentalization, right? If you ask yourself, what is the nature of love is the non-instrumental relationship. You love the other, you don't use him. It's not a market exchange relationship. The sacred as well is supposedly the realm that doesn't allow instrumentalization, right? Even Kedushat Makom, you ask yourself, what is the sacredness of space? The Mishnah says, Kedushat Batei Knesset, Shelo Yaseu Kapandria, right? You cannot make a shortcut out of a space of a synagogue. That means that a sacred space is the non-instrumental realm. If you look at the political agents and their actions, I want to take two moments for the first theme, which is power and instrumentalization, as it relates to love and the sacred. The one is a very telling moment of love and instrumentalization. I want to talk about Saul's relationship, Saul and David relationship to Michal, right? We know already, commentator said that Michal is the first time where love is attributed to a woman in the Bible, right? Love of a man. And I'm going to read just short verses. this is in chapter 19. David is in the court. Saul is very concerned about his rising power. He cannot kill him directly, but he wants to kill him indirectly via Plishtim. And then here's the good news. Vatehav Michal bat Shaul et David. Michal loves David. Vayagidu leShaul. Right? And Shaul is being told about that. Vayishar adavar beenav. That's actually, he approves of it. And you said, well, a father approves of that love because he likes the shidduch, right? He thinks that's a good shidduch. But then, ironically, and not ironically, sadly, he says in verse 21, Vayomer Shaul etnena lo, I will give her to him, v'tei lo lemokesh, Veteibo Yad Plishtim. This is his daughter. He's going to use her So we know the plot afterwards because he demands dowry, and the dowry is Orlot Plishtim, which will put him in danger, and he will die. And here's a father using the love of a child, of his daughter, of Michal. He actually approves of it. And you wonder, says, wow, a father approves of the love of a daughter, right? And he instrumentalizes that. By the way, this is a man who at the beginning of his career was Nechba el Akelim. He didn't want to be a king. He was a very anav. He had midat anava. I'm reading in Shmuel Aleph, chapter 18, verse 20. By the way, it's not only Saul who's instrumentalizing the love of Michal, it's also David, because David wants through her to get the approval of belonging to the royal family, getting some legitimacy as an outsider. And this poor woman is torn between two powerful men who each of them is using her, right? Is using her. And you see how the nature of power corrupts the basic fabric of human relationship, love, or undermines what we will call a human space that is presumably protected from instrumentalization. I want to talk about another realm of instrumentalization and then go to the second theme. I said we're going to have four themes on power. The second case belongs to the sacred. By the way, I said the sacred. The sacred, like love, is the realm of the non-instrumental. And this is a moment when David runs from Shaul, he escapes from Shaul, and he seeks temporary help from the priests at Nov. Now I am at chapter 21, verse 1. In Samuel 1. Yonatan tells David that the king is threatening him. David runs. Yonatan returns back and David walks away. Vayavo David Nova אל אחימלך הכהן, he comes to אחימלך in Nov, ויחרד אחימלך לקראת דוד, אחימלך is concerned about David, ויאמר לו, מדוע אתה לבדך ואין איש איתך? Why are you alone? This is improper to a high-ranking official in the king's court. This is David. And then he lies to him and says, ויאמר דוד לאחימלך הכהן. He says to him, המלך ציווני דבר, I mean the mission sent by whom? By the king. ויאמר אליי, איש על ידה מאומה את הדבר אשר אנוכי שולחך ואשר ציוויתיך. It's a secret mission, this is why I am alone. ואת הנערים יודעתי אל מקום פלוני ופלוני, and the servants who are with me, I told them, come to a certain place even without telling them the nature of the mission. So he uses secrecy By the way, always secrecy is the realm of deception in politics. Now he says, "Vata ma yesh biyadcha tachat yadcha chamisha lechem, kna biyadi wa nimtzai." He needs supply. He says, "Do you have food, bread?" Vayan haKohen et David vayomer en lechem chol el tachat yadi ki im lechem kodesh. Yesh im nishmeru anearim ach miisha. Right? You have to eat it, this lechem kodesh, under only conditions of purity. And then he tells him, "It's fine. We are all pure." And he makes him a collaborator in helping a suspect of the king. He puts him in danger. And then the verse says, "Vesham ish me'avdei Shaul." I'm skipping to verse 8. "Vesham ish me'avdei Shaul b'yom ha'u ne'etzar lifnei Hashem." He came also to worship God, one of the servants of God. "Ushmo do'ega adomi abir aroim asher leShaul." And you wonder, does David see that Doeg is there? Soon we will see that he knows that Doeg is there as well. "Vayomer David le'achimelech, ve'en yesh po tachat yadcha chanit o cherev, ki gam charbi ve'gam kelai lo lakachti biyadi, ki yad dvar ha'melech nachutz." Says, "I was in such a rush for performing the mission of the king, I didn't bring weapons." And then the Kohen, the poor Kohen, gives him what? The sword of Goliath, a very prestigious sword. This is a case of instrumentalizing not a relationship of love, but the devotion of the sacred. And the obligation of hospitality. By the way, I just want to say, everybody who learns, who studies carefully Sefer Shmuel knows that the sacred is instrumentalized through and through all the time. God is out of the picture to a certain degree, but he's used again and again. How do we know it? When David established Jerusalem, right, takes Jerusalem as his capital, after he conquers the Jerusalem, the first thing he wants to do is what? To bring whom to the city? God. By bringing the ark, because it's very good for the political center to have the temple next to it. By the way, God doesn't like it. Didn't like it. And when David brings the ark, at least at the first try, there is death, right, Uzziah. And then, by the way, when he wants to build him a home, God says, "I really don't need you to build me a home." Because they understand, we are in Yerushalayim, we are in the realm where the sacred is instrumentalized all the time, right? This is the capital of idolatry in that respect, right? If it's sacred to me, it's mine. Now, so politics, the first theme, I'm just taking two incidents. What's interesting about this incident is that they cut into the fabric of the most basic components of human relationship that are supposedly protected from instrumentalization. Love and the sacred. But we have a very shrewd author. We have a very perceptive author. Now we come to the second theme. It has to do with power and paranoia. And it is very much related to the first theme. Because at the moment you instrumentalize those whom you love, or those whom you supposedly love, like Michal, right, who's being used, this is a gender structure as well, you cannot trust anybody not to instrumentalize you. This is the structure of relationship now. And you begin to develop a powerful streak of paranoia. By the way, the best portrayal still in the Hebrew literature of political paranoia is the breakdown of Saul psychically. He breaks down. He loses it. Because madness, the psychological condition of madness is the loss of your capacity to read reality for what it is, almost in the most simple level of reality. And when it comes to the breakdown of this, the king, it has to do with the loss of his capacity to read his immediate environment. But that comes hand in hand with the first theme. And paranoia, we can have few shiurim on that theme in the book of Samuel. What does it do to power? The isolation of power. The person in power is isolated. Is completely isolated by his own ways of dealing with his environment. He has no genuine space of trust. But paranoia leads to violence. And here, we come back to the poor Kohen of Nov. And it's a very interesting moment. I'm just reading from Shmuel Aleph, chapter 22. Now, Saul is in the middle of the pursuit of David. And he begins to reflect aloud around his environment in verse 6. This is one of the most powerful portrayal of the condition of isolation of power. Vayishma Shaul ki noda David va'anashim ishir asher ito. He hears that David is running with a group of people. ושאול יושב בגבעה תחת האש של ברמה וחניתו בידו וכל עבדיו ניצבים עליו. The immediate circle is around him. ויאמר שאול לעבדיו הניצבים עליו. He says to this immediate circle. שימון הבני ימיני. By the way, they are all what? Belong to what? To his tribe. There is a blood relationship. Presumably, this is your base that you trust the most, your blood. גם לכולכם ייתן בן ישי שדות וכרמים, לכולכם ישים שרי אלפים ושרי מאות. He will give you fields and he promised you high offices in his future monarchy. כי קשרתם עליי כולכם. You are all what? Conspiring against me. קשרתם עליי כולכם. ואין גולה את אוזני. I am surrounded by a secret wall of conspiracy. בכרות בני עם בן ישי. Even whom? My son. ואין חולה מכם עליי. By the way, this is a very interesting term. In Hebrew it says, חולה עליך is a completely different use in the slogan. Means I have a crush on you. But אין חולה מכם עליי, this is the Hebrew word for empathy. By the way, the history of empathy is interesting. Nobody feels my pain. Nobody feels my suffering here. I'm isolated completely. וגולה את אוזני. כי הקים בני את עבדי, את עבדי עליי לעורב כיום הזה, I'm ambushed. So he is expressing paranoia and isolation. Right? ויאמר, ויען דואג האדומי, והוא ניצב על עבדי שאול, ויאמר, ראיתי את בן ישי בנובה אל אחימלך בן החיטוב. After the call of conspiracy, someone comes up and says, what? I'm going to tell you. Who is he, by the way? It's interesting. He is what? an outsider. The burden of loyalty on the outsider, right? He has to prove loyalty, and he says, I saw the priest. וישאל לו בהשם וצידה נתן לו ואת חרב גוליאד הפלישתי נתן לו. He supported him. וישלח המלך לקרוא את אחי מלך בן החיטוב הכהן ואת כל בית אביו הכהנים אשר בנוב ויבואו כולם אל המלך. ויומר שאול שמנה בן החיטוב ויומר הנני אדוני ויומר אליו שאול למה קשרתם עליי? Why are you conspiring against me? אתה ובן ישי בתיתך לו חרב ולחם ושאול לו באלוהים לקום אליי לעורב כיום הזה. He is already suspecting whom as well. פור אחי מלך. ויאמר ויען אחי מלך אל המלך ויאמר מי בכל עבודיך כדוד נאמן. I thought he is a loyal servant. וחתן המלך, he is your son in law. ושר אל משמעתך, he is under your authority. ונכבד בביתך. Right, and he swears, "Al yasem ha-melech be'avdo davar b'chol beit abi, ki lo yada avdecha b'chol zot davar katan o gadol." I'm completely innocent here. Vayomer ha-melech mot tamut, achi melech ata v'chol beitcha. Vayomer ha-melech l'ratzim ha-nitzavim alav sovu v'amitu kohanei Adonai, ki gam yada min David, v'ki yadu ki boreachu, v'lo galu et ozni. V'lo avdu ha-me ha-melech lishloach et yadam lifgoa b'kohanei Adonai. The inner circle refuses to do what? A horrible crime of killing the priests. Who does it? ויאמר המלך לדואג, סוב אתה ופגע בכהנים, ויסוב דואג האדומי ויפגע הוא בכהנים, וימת ביום ההוא 85 איש נושאי אפוד בד. It's a horrible story. But it's a story of what? Of political paranoia. And the way we know that from the stories of terror and politics. By the way, one of the functions of political paranoia is to demand from your inner circle acts of horrible violence to prove what? Their loyalty. And here is the ultimate violence against the sacred. By the way, don't be aware that David didn't know all of that because David is a very clever guy. Right, and he says, "Eviatar runs away." Vayaged Eviatar le David ki arak Shaul et Kohanei Adonai. Vayomer David le Eviatar yadati bayom ahu ki sham doeg Adomi ki yaged yagid le Shaul. Anochi savoti bechol nefesh beit avicha. He says, "I knew that." He saw. So you ask yourself, if you saw doeg there, why did you do it? It's you cannot resist using your environment completely, even the price of endangering them. So here is the second theme. The second theme is isolation of power and the price of paranoia and loyalty. By the way, you see just from these verses, besides just the beauty of the writing, that this author knows something about power. He understands it from within. But I want to go to our third theme, which is the main text we want to study closely. And that has to do with the nature of political agency. And I want to read again a text that is known to all of us. I'm not sure. En Beit Midrash Belo Chidush. I hope we can say something new about this text. But it is within the context of our larger issue. And I will begin to read and interpret. And my main quest is to uncover the astuteness of the author's understanding of politics, and then ask, at the end, we're going to have to ask, what can we learn from all that? Vayi li tshuvat ha-shana, I'm reading Samuel 2, chapter 11. Le'etzet ha-malachim, vayishlach David et Yoav ve'et avadav imo ve'et kol Yisrael vayashchitu et bnei Amon ויצורו על רבא ודוד יושב בירושלים. By the way, here will come a verb that is this key to this whole chapter, which is what? וישלח. David sends. Okay? I want to give you now a rule in violence and politics. The more powerful you are, the larger the causal chain you can create that separates between you and the violence you inflict. Okay? If you're really powerful, the chain can be actually very long. And the verb vayishlach is the key of separation between the author of the violence and the act of violence. And we're going to have to deal with the meaning of that. But so David sends everybody out there. He is in Jerusalem, which is also a remark not only on the nature of political power, but on the nature of decadence. This is a decadent man. He's already comfortable. He sends his troop away. He's not there with them. He's in Yerushalayim. Not only that he is in the home while his troops are at the front. Vayi le'et erev, vayakom David, me'al mishkavo, vayitalech al gag ha'bayit. He also had a good what? Siesta. Right? He's very comfortable at home, right? And le'et erev, you can imagine, we know where the city of David is. You can feel, this is, right, this is summer. That's when wars are conducted. He wants to enjoy the evening Jerusalem breeze, right? Vayitalech al gag beito. Vayar, ויער אישה רוחצת מעל הגג, ואישה טובת מראה. Right. He engages in what we will call urban voyeurism. וישלח דוד, he sends דוד, וידרוש לאישה, ויאמר הלא זאת בת שבע בת אליעם אשת אוריה החיתי, וישלח דוד מלאכים ויקחיה, ותבוא אליו הישכב עמה, והיא מתקדשת מתומתה, ותשוב אל ביתה. ותר האישה, ותשלח, ותגת לדוד, ותומר הרה אנוכי. There's a lot of sending here. He does it, he's entitled. We're going to get to the fourth theme, which has to do with power and entitlement. He's entitled. Vayishlach David el Yoav. Shlach elai et Uriah chiti, vayishlach Yoav et Uriah el David. Right? Again, he is incapable of... he has a chain, he has shlichim. ויבוא אוריה אליו, אוריה קמז, וישאל דוד לשלום יואב ולשלום העם ולשלום המלחמה. He wants to create an alibi for why? Why do you call an officer from the front? As if his concern is to get information of what's happening out there in the front. After all, if you were Uriah, you would wonder, why the hell I'm being called. maybe a promotion, maybe demotion. No, the king is very concerned about Shlom Ha'am. ויאמר דוד לאוריה, רד לביתך ורחץ רגליך. Go home, you know, feel comfortable. ויצא אוריה מבית המלך ותצא אחריו מסעת המלך. Right, he is also giving him some goods, I guess some food and wine, champagne. וישכב אוריה פתח בית המלך. את כל עבדי אדוניו ואל ולא ירד אל ביתו. אוריה is not willing to go home, and here I guess the story wants to express the deep difference between the decadence of the king and the solidarity of the warrior. But by the way, you wonder, what does Uriah know? Does he know? Is he suspicious? But we know that he is suspicious. Soon we'll see, I think. ויגידו לדוד לאמור, לא ירד אוריה אל ביתו. They tell him, he didn't go home. ויאמר דוד אל אוריה, לא מדרך אתה בא. מדוע לא ירדת אל ביתך? Right, we know soldiers. They love to come home and have a taste of the comfort of home. ויום אוריה אל דוד, אהרון וישראל ויהודה יושבים בסוכות. ואדוני דוד ועבדי אדוני על פני השדה חונים. They're all in the field. ואני אבוא אל ביתי לאכול ולשתות ו... לשכב עם אשתי. By the way, here we know, or I would say the author, who's such a great author, wants us to think that maybe Uriah thinks that that's the plot, because the king didn't tell him what. Go לשכב עם אשתך, he tell him go home. חייך וחי נפשך אם אעשה את הדבר הזה. ויאמר דוד אל אוריה, שב בזה גם היום ומחר אשלחך. He says, well, we know loyalties tend to erode. Let's wait, give him some more time. וישב אוריה בירושלים ביום ההוא ממחרת, ויקרא לו דוד ויוכל לפניו, וישת וישקרהו, ויצא בערב לשכב ומשכבו עם עבדי אדוניו, ואל ביתו לא ירד. He's a strong, he resists all of that. ויהי בבוקר, ויכתוב דוד ספר אל יואב, וישלח ביד אוריה. That's to see the loyalty of the soldier. Because David knows that what? Uriah is not going to what? To open the letter. He sends his execution note with him. ויכתוב בספר לאמור, אבו את אוריה אל מול פני המלחמה החזקה, ושבתם מאחוריו וניקה ומת. Put him at the toughest position in the front. You should all withdraw and he will be killed. By the way, this is the nature of political agency. At the end, two things we know here. At the end, it's not David who's going to kill him. At the end, who is going to kill him? The enemy, Bnei Amon. That's a power of politics. He can maneuver all that. He doesn't have to stab him. By the way, I just want to say one thing about the nature of political crime. Political crime is always divided among many agents. One collects the information, one does this, one does that. If you're very powerful, the victim himself can be part of the causal chain that will bring his demise. We know that from horrible situations with the Germans, you know, Nazis did it. You can create a chain that you, it's not only that you're not going to inflict the violence, it's the victim himself will gonna do it to himself. Now, what does this structure do? It does two things. First of all, it allows to distribute the responsibility across so many agents that there is no one responsible. David didn't kill him. At the end, it was Bnei Amon who killed him. But second, and I want to say something about political action at its best. You expect, what is the nature of a political role? You're in office. You're in office, it means you're not allowed to bring your own interests and judgments to your job. Right? That's a loyal political agent, which allows you the fantasy as if you are completely, you are disassociated from what you're doing. Because after all, you're not doing your own things. By the way, these two things, the nature, the distribution of agency across many agents, and the inbuilt disassociation that comes from acting as a someone, as a judge, as a soldier, as this, as that, which actually, it's a good thing in politics, can be a vehicle, can be used to allow the self-deception, to ease the act of violence. By the way, what is the nature of political criticism under this condition of chain, long chain of agents, is to make the chain transparent and to bring the end result to its source. This is what Nathan says to David at the end, Ve'oto aragta becherev bnei Amon. You killed him with the sword of bnei Amon. Okay, but now we will see that our author is so subtle about the nature of political agency and the causal chain created by the powerful, that there is an added element to everything we said that intensifies the nature of violence. It says the following. Now Yoav, the second in the chain. You expect him what? To say, wait a second, I know what's the charge? By the way, if there was a charge, it should have been what? Public. Right? Why is this guy executed? Why is this secrecy? Why do we have to do it through Bnei Amon and all that? It stinks. No, he follows orders. By the way, he has his own reasons to follow orders. But he does something very interesting. Vayi bishmor Yoav el ha'ir, while Yoav is surrounding the city, vayiten et Uriya el ha'makom asher yada ki anshei chayil sham. He knew where their strong enemy positions there. ויצאו אנשי העיר וילחמו את יואב ויפול מן העם מעבדי דוד וימות גם אוריה החיתי. What does Yoav do? He improves on the order, right? He improves on the order. Because not only Uriah dies, but the whole unit is gone. Now you ask yourself, what is the motivation of Yoav to improve the order? And the answer is very clear. This is a command he cannot give the troops because it's so transparent that he is part of execution of Uriah that all of his troops either will rebel or will know that he did it. They know Uriah, by the way, we are all very sympathetic with Uriah. He must have been liked by his unit. So in order to create his own alibi, he has to kill some more people. Basically, here is a very good rule in politics. In order to protect one lie, you need a whole bunch of lies. There is not such a thing as isolated deception. Right? Deception needs a world around it. So what is he doing? He's killing some more people, but we understand it. Here is a second sub-theme in the third theme of power, which is there is a chain of agents, but as order goes through the chain, it's improved. It's improved because those agents have to what? Protect themselves as well in the action. And now the price of blood gets bigger and bigger. By the way, one thing which is very interesting about this type of narrative, what makes, as a narrative form, what makes it so powerful, is that the author doesn't tell you that something interesting happens here. He just tells you the story. He's not waving a red flag here. Right? So we have to be very attuned to what's going on. Now, I think it's the most subtle moment in all this chapter. There is another messenger. Vayishlach Yoav, here Yoav also sends. Vayaged le David et kol divrei ha-milchama. He gives him a report. ויצב את המלאך למור. כחלותך את כל דברי המלחמה לדבר עם המלך, when you tell the king everything, והיה אם תעלה חמת המלך, then the king will get very angry, very upset, ואמר לך, מדוע ניגשתם אל העיר להילחם? הלא ידעתם אשר יורו מעל החומה. Why did you do this stupid thing to get close to the wall? Those who are on top of the wall have such an advantage. מי יקה את אבימלך בן ירובשת? הלא אישה ישליחה עליו פלך רכב מעל החומה והיומת בטבץ. Right, even there is an intertextual rage. Right, he refers, you know that story. למה ניגשתם אל החומה? When the king will be so enraged, tell him what? ואמרת, גם אוריח, גם עבדך אוריח איתי מת, then what? We assume that what? He'll relax. By the way, basically, what does Yoav, first of all, he shows that he can manipulate the emotional structure of the boss. But another thing that he does, through that message, it's clear that the aim was what? The death of Uriah. Right? He said the king will be very upset about that we lost people. Tell him Uriah died, he will be fine. Now, it's interesting what the messenger does. Right? It's a moment of great political perception. Vayelech HaMalach ויגד לדוד את כל אשר שלחו יואב. He told him everything. ויומר המלאך אל דוד, כי גברו אלינו אנשים, ויצאו אלינו השדה, ואני אהיה אליהם עד פתח השער. He said, people, they came out, right? They came to us, and we began to pursue them. This was the reason we got close to the wall. ויראו המוראים אל עבדיך מעל החומה וימותו מעבדי המלך V'gam Uriah Chiti met. In what way does the messenger changes the message? He also improves on the message, like Yoav. He does two things. First of all, he creates a reasonable story. How did it happen that they found themselves under the wall? But second, he doesn't do what? He doesn't cut the narrative into two. He doesn't say, well, we lost a lot of people under the wall. The king gets enraged and then he says, but Uriah also died, it's fine. Why doesn't he do that? Because he has to what? Protect himself. Because if the king will know that he knows, who knows what will happen to him? He might carry his own letter of death to the front. Right? He knows this is a dangerous bunch of people. But the subtlety of how the story is being retold. Now you ask yourself, Yoav is a shrewd guy. Why does Yoav... Why is Yoav not telling the king the story that the messenger told the king to start with? Because Yoav wants to send the message to the king, there are other people who know, and you better be well behaved, because if you not well behave, more people will know. Here is a third theme in the second theme, in the third theme of power, which is the following. Loyalty, among other things, the power of the chain is the, you create loyalty by infecting more and more people with the crimes you do. That's a good thing. But the moment you do it and you expose yourself, now you are completely at their hands. Now they can squeeze you and use you. You have lost your authority as a leader by infecting the chain with your crime at the moment you thought it will create loyalty. This is a paradox, a non-paradox in political action. Now, comes the ultimate verse 25. This is a verse that should be hanged everywhere in every office that deals with war. As a warning. ויאמר דוד אל המלאך, כה תאמר אל יואב, אל ירא בעיניך את הדבר הזה. Let's not be upset about this whole thing. כי כזו וכזה תאכל החרב. Right. It's, by the way, is a metaphor of violence. It's one of the greatest metaphors of violence. The sword has what? A mouth. And the sword eats. Right? Acherev ochelet. As if there is no one what? That holds the sword. Right? If you want to understand the effect of what we will call division of labor in politics in terms of agency and what the sort of self-deception that it allows and disassociation, this is the ultimate of it, which is the machinery of war as such, as a logic into itself. We are all in some ways victims of the violence we inflict. The sword eats. It has a mouth of its own. It's like an organism right? It's a predator, the sword. And you wonder, is nobody holding the sword? There's no... Well, nobody is holding the sword because it was anyhow the sword of Naamon who killed Uriah. Kaze v'chazo tochal acheret. Okay. This is, as I said, a great tract in the nature of political crime. And its structure, what I will call, we talked about politics and as instrumentalization, the first theme. The second theme is politics, power and isolation and paranoia. And the third theme is the problem of agency in political action, as it emerges through descending. And here the very interesting themes came, how the chain works and what does it, and its effects. Okay, I want to say a few things just about chapter 13, which unfortunately we want to have a discussion. I cannot read line by line. But this is our fourth theme on power. And it has to do with the nature of continuity of power and its self-defeating aspects. As we said in the beginning, in the introduction, we know politics is very concerned with the transfer of power. The moment of the death of the ruler is or the end of his, for a variety of reasons, is a very delicate moment for all political structure, the threat of political vacuum. Monarchy is a way of ensuring transfer of power through bloodline. There is a continuity of power. It's an answer, but there is always a problem, which is, if it is a bloodline, there will be what? Few contenders. There will be few contenders. And now comes a whole complex structure of family and power, love and power, though love was undermined in a very complicated way in this story. And if we follow the first transfer of power within the family, there are actually two transfers of power in the story. The transfer of power from Shaul to David, with the whole story into itself, how that occurs. But then there is the transfer of power within Davidic family. And there are a few kids there. There is Amnon, and Avshalom, and Adoniah, and Shlomo. By the way, what happened to all of them? One rapes his sister. The other one is being killed by the other brother. The other brother, Avshalom, then rebels against the father, being killed by the father's warriors. Then Adoniah is being killed by Shlomo. A very nasty story. In the first stage of what is supposedly simple transfer of power. We want to look at the next generation waiting for power. That's chapter 13. And there are three things we can say about them. First of all, they are entitled. They're soon to be the king. Who's the entitled one here is who? Amnon. Also, they are surrounded by relatives. They are not going to get there, but they're close enough to be resentful of why they're not there. Who's this character here? Who's the most cunning of all characters in this story? Yeah. Yonadav. He's the cousin. He's not the direct bloodline, but he looks at his cousins and says, why the hell them? And he's resentful. And he knows them fairly well. And he comes and says to Amnon, ולאמנון רע, ושמו יונדב בן שמעה, אחי דוד, right, he's the cousin, ויונדם איש חכם. By the way, it's not always a compliment. then verse 4. ויאמר לו, מדוע אתה ככה דל בן המלך בבוקר? It's a beautiful line. why Dal will be, why do you look so depressed and melancholic in the morning? Mele in the evening, after heavy drinking. But baboker, it doesn't, power has to project what? Exuberance, right? You see those politicians, they always project kind of, they have fun in the job, they're exuberant. And here's this entitled prince who looks kind of melancholic. Melancholy is the condition of longing for something you don't have. This cannot be possible for a prince soon to be the king. And then, you know, then there is a whole scheme, the rape of Tamar. I mean, we can read it closely. There's so many beautiful moments, beautiful, horrible moments in this thing. I just want to point to one moment in the verse. One moment in the verse. The objectification of the rape, right? This is one word. You know which word did I mean? Zot, right? Where, when he throws it out of the Yudzayin. Vayikra et na'aro mesharto vayomer la shilchu na et zot me'alai achutza une'ol ade. Wow, that's whoever wrote that, right? I'm not sure how it's translated here. Put now this woman, that's not a... That one. She's objectified. It's not etaisha zot. And then, but I just want to say one... First of all, there is entitlement. There's entitlement. Second, they're competing between them. There is entitlement, competition, and also they're very impatient. Because at the moment Avshalom sees weakness in his father, he begins what? A rebellion. Is they're not going to wait because also they're competing with one another. But the last, I just want to make the last comment about this verse, this chapter, which I think is the genius of the chapter. And then we're going to do some conclusion and we'll open a conversation. The one who allows everything to happen in this chapter is whom? David. Right? He does two things. First of all, he sends Tamar to whom? To Amnon. But then he also what? Sends Amnon to whom? To Avshalom. And he knows, right? By the way, in his conversation with Avshalom, you feel that he knows. Because he says, why do you need them all? He's afraid. And you ask yourself, and the children use him. This is onesh, this is the perfect punishment. Because they use the power that he has to send against him. Right? This is why the chapter begins, Vayi achar advarim ha'ele. After what happened with Batsheva, this happened. And you ask yourself, what? They're using his power to send, to destroy his family from within. The rape of the sister, the killing of the older brother, Amnon. By the way, Amnon is the older brother. That's an important thing. Now, just in terms of, that follows now the third theme. It's when the powerful has done what he did, he lost the most important thing of a leader and a father, which is his moral authority. He has no moral authority. And that creates his own weakness vis-a-vis his own children, which is the one who uses all the manipulating structures of power also will be manipulated himself into his own self-demise. This is what's so powerful in this chapter. And there is much to say in terms of the close reading of the chapter. But I want to sum up, and then let's open a conversation. What I just try to open 2 years of study of what I would call our deepest book about politics that we have in our tradition, which is Sefer Shmuel. It is the deepest book about politics. And it's penetrating, I highlight 4 themes. By the way, many of them are connected to one another in a deep way. First, power and instrumentalization is a theme. By the way, it's very interesting. You look at the book in its totality, and you ask, who really in that book did a pure act of giving? You begin to be paranoid yourself, because you understand that for those players, morality is also a tactics. And there are moments, I would say the most beautiful moment in the story is when the Baalat Ov helps Shaul in his distress. Right? The most marginal outcast of all the characters there is capable of doing an act which you at least don't feel suspicious about its motives. This king is going to die, he's gone, he's broken, he's isolated, he came to her, and she slaughters for him the last of the good cattle that she has to comfort him. This is, if you want to look at a different version of the Last Supper, this is the version. Okay. So that's the first theme. And by the way, very interesting for us to talk about instrumentalization of the sacred. That begins in the book, by the way, the story of the ark and taking the ark to the war by Eli. There's a whole narrative here of the sacred and politics. But we saw a moment of it, David and the priests. That's the first theme. The second theme that I wanted to highlight is power and isolation. Now, isolation, for those who are in power, is a very destructive element in their humanity, in their capacity to read the world that they are in. And incapable of judging the world. At the moment of paranoia and conspiracy, the only mode of treating the world is through the most secure means that you have at your disposal, which is what? Violence. Just kill them all, if you can. And also by that you create loyalty of the people of the inner circle around you. That's the second theme. The third theme, which I think still is the most important for us modern, is the complexity of political agency. As it's told in the political crime of killing of Uriah, and the goal, and here I'm talking about the critical goal of political critique, here is a rule, always make the chain transparent to its source. Right. V'oto arakta b'cherev bnei Amon. Then comes our fourth theme that has to do with those who are near power, the ones who smell it, the ones who are close to it. And the impatience, the competition, the entitlement. And the way in which, within the story of monarchy, which is, after all, the story of the book of Shmuel, the world in which love and power, the father and his children. There is a point where David, the incapacity of the father to set a limit. By the way, with children, if you don't set limit, we know that no limits are very bad. But by the way, even if you don't set limits to your own children, the world will set limits to them. They will hit the wall, but not when they're princes. This is a very dangerous moment. And him losing, him first of all being to start to weak towards his children, and also losing the moral authority. He's manipulated by them to bring his own demise. All these are not just peculiar to this particular troubling story. They're structural to these structures of power. So I want to say, in our tradition, if you ask me, a great book on politics, on power, on violence, on the nature of it, on the dangers of it, it's Sefer Shmuel. And by the way, you wonder about the author, right? This is not Yonadav. He must be very close to what's happening inside, right? But he channels his resentment through a very devastating moral critique of what's going on around, right? We would love to meet him or her. Maybe it's Michal's daughter who wrote the book at the end. It's kind of a reflection of... In any event, I wanted to share these thoughts about violence and power in our tradition, in what I think is the deepest, most astute statement. Maybe in politics, not only in the Jewish tradition, maybe in political tracts in general, and some issues that we can learn from. So let's open the discussion and we'll begin. Yes, please.
So we spoke about the idea of politics and love. Can you say another couple of words on Natan and the power of Nebuah?
Right.
Open up that transparency for the
right.
Change
right. So We want to understand what is the nature of political criticism. Actually, by the way, all this book is an act in political criticism in itself, the author telling the story. But it's someone who's independent of this and confronts power. Right? And confronts power by speaking the truth, in that respect, transparency to the powerful. So, by the way, the Nevuah begins in Israel, the real Nevuah begins in Israel when monarchy begins. Right? We have a Navi, Shmuel is Navi, but Shmuel is a Roe, he is a future, he tells the future. Right? It's interesting that in biblical political theory, Nevuah begins when monarchy begins. Why? Because monarchy needs an outside voice. Power needs a voice that will break its own isolation. Right? If we would have had time to pursue that question, and this is a question that who are watching power to a certain degree, you have to ask yourself, what is the nature of effective political critique? Right? There is a very beautiful book by Michael Walzer called about political social criticism. And he asks himself, what is the best effective social criticism? By the way, you look at the history of prophets and you ask, who really succeeded? There was one prophet who had a major success, you know, Yonah, right? By the way, the prophet who didn't want to prophesy, and Yoytze Zayin, right, he says, Be'od 40 yom ninve nehefechet, and he walked away. If they would send them Yirmiyahu, we're going to have 3 books on Nineveh, at least. So there is, there is an irony about prophetic speech. Say, the overkill of critical rhetoric. I mean, it's quite fascinating how this prophet who didn't want to prophesy says one thing. He didn't say, Yada shor koneu v'chamor evus v'alav v'ami lo yada. Oy goy chote am keved avon. It's just said. In 40 days you're gone. It was very effective. Okay. So there is one issue that emerges from that question that for us to study in terms of Jewish political thought is the nature of political criticism, the role of the prophet. But it's clear to us one thing, that this whole realm needs an outside voice which is not alienated, is a caring voice. Because part of the problem of political critique is patronizing, alienation, and being the role of the superego of the community. By the way, I think communities do not like their superegos for a particular reason. That's always the problem a little bit with the politics of the left. By the way, I'm talking to myself now. It's a complex act of political rhetoric, of blaming. At a certain moment, you think that your role in life is to distribute blame among different parties, becoming superego of the system. Well, people resent their superegos. They resent their own superego. They resent it when it's being projected with a voice outside. So what does it mean to criticize from within? That's always the challenge of political critique. But that's what Natan does, right? He leads him. He leads him to his own, he awakens his own moral sensibility by the story he tells, right? Ataish. Okay, yes. Right.
As making him an effective slaughterer. Could you speak about Uriah the Hittite-ness and how it makes him an effective slaughterer?
Victim, right. That's the, you're right. We have a story about an Adomi and about Hitti. And he's an easier target because he doesn't have a family base. He doesn't have a home base. And the striking opposition between his outsideness and his loyalty, right? And the vulnerability of these two conditions. If you ask me, that makes him a weak target. Right. Yes, that's a good. Yes, please.
I found this story, I don't know why it was ringing in my ear, the story of Jacob. He also has a daughter that was raised, and he does absolutely nothing.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting. I would say the following comment. If you look at the vulnerable, those who are morally most vulnerable in terms of biblical thinking on victims, they could be, and let's take the story of Sdom and Lot. You have the outsiders, the malachim, right? People think they have no protection. The people in the city want what? To rape them. So they are very vulnerable, like Uriah. They're vulnerable. And then you have the other group who's vulnerable is not the ultimate other, but the one who's very close to you, whom you think it's part of you, which is Lot's daughters that he trades for his obligations of hospitality, right? Then you have those who are protected are those who are not distant enough from you and those who are not close enough to you. I would say, you might say, the town, the people in the town, your neighbors. But the vulnerability comes at the patriarchal force of ownership of your own and the complete lack of careness to the other. The one who, this is, by the way, the story of Pilegesh Bagiva again, right? That has the similar structure of what we will call, who are the vulnerable spots among the sick. So this all thing are connected to some of the themes we are talking about. Yes, yes, please.
You talked about suggesting that he knew what the king was up to and that he more people that knew
right.
And I'm wondering where it says that he makes up the story, or like, tells the story that there was this woman who was the one who drops the millstone on the soldiers. If that's sort of a hint, because it mentions a woman.
That's interesting. That's interesting.
Say, hey, maybe, right. You know, Bathsheba, we know there's something going on here with another woman.
That's interesting. I didn't think, yes, it's very suggestive. I mean, on the level, the immediate level, yeah, it's interesting, yeah, a very suggestive possibility, yes.
Can you make a comment about Bathsheba? Usually a woman in the Bible is referenced to a man, a father, a husband, or a brother. She's referenced to two. She's referenced to Uriah, she's referenced to a father, and if you go to the second book of Samuel, chapter 23, where they list David's honor God, you find out that Eliam is the son of Ahitophel, the advisor to the king. So she is no stranger to the intrigues of the palace.
Yeah.
And if you look at the three verbs where David takes her and by Shkabima, and the center is Bataboila.
Right.
So it's consensual.
Yeah.
So how does she fit into this palace room?
Definitely an element to ponder about, right? What does she know? Is this a rape under power? Is this seduction? Is this, is she arranging it? Is she also using the fact that Uriah is distant? Did Uriah talk to her? Though he didn't come home, he must have exchanged some words with her. This is the sort of gaps, typical gaps, that the narrator leaves for us to fill in, and we can fill it in different directions. At the end, she has her own son being the king. That's the end of the story. We can write a novel about Bathsheba as well, among other characters in the story. Yes.
Along the same lines, would you comment on the political nature of the rape? That it might not just have been a rape, but
yeah.
Sexual politics?
Yeah. Yeah, because that's that means I am now the patriarch of this family. Right. It's absolutely this, right? Clearly there is a passion, this, but it sends a message in the home, in the house. Yeah. But Avshalom, again, Tamar, in a completely different sense, is also a pawn, like Michal, but of a more brutal politics, because Avshalom really is using her now for his own ambitions to create an alibi for killing the older son, because he's the next in line. So if we want to talk about the theme of instrumentalization being woven into the ones who are near power, And these are very good comments. Yes.
In terms of the succession question, I wonder what you make of the fact that the ultimate successor is Solomon comes from David's original overreaching.
Yeah.
And he's there before Amnon and Absalom start their whole dramatic encounter. He's already been born. So what do you think the narrator might be suggesting?
I think the narrator... See, the narrator is, this is not a story the court will approve of, right, naturally. This is not positive press, as we will say today. If you ask me, he wants to taint the lineage, right? He wants to say, I understand the story the following way. There was this idea that God is the king. This is the book of Judges. Now, this is intolerable political idea. This is manic depressive politics, right? This is, the people need stability. Now, stability means a power that will have the power to tax and to draft. You're going to have a standing army. You're not going to have an ad hoc militia leader that will call against your enemies when the other side has tanks, there's chariots. You need taxation and draft, one thing, and you need continuity. And that's what monarchy provides. So God said, okay, you cannot tolerate this idea of the kingdom of God, the way the book of Judges, I give up. But let's see how this unfolds.
Story about stories. In the story, people are telling stories about the stories that they're telling. Because power is legitimated by narrative, by stories. And this is a complete undermining of anybody's political narrative, because when you close the book, you can't believe anything anybody says.
speaking of tainted lineage and tikkun, so how do we reconcile that from this very tainted lineage which the author wants to demonstrate? We fast forward both in terms of the Tanakh and fast forward to the future. We go to Yeshayahu Perek Yud Aleph. From the same lineage comes what's described there as Melech HaMashiach, this ideal. How does...
We call it utopia. I mean, there is this voice. There is not one voice, clearly, but maybe not one voice in the story. Absolutely. A different voice. Yes.
A lot of references to various stories in the some are to the way she described desirable love. There's a reference to Joseph, and there's reference to God holding the kingdom. Yeah. It's all in there.
Absolutely.
Way of saying, you know, that the Bible says that the king should always represent the Bible and always keep it alone.
Yeah, that's true.
Is this where Machiavelli got the idea of the prince right from this text?